Okay, now welcome to the third part of our lecture on positive displacement compressor. So for last lecture we have discussed that there are three possibilities with which the compression process will occur. Now today we have to discuss that what are the requirements for these three possibilities, or we can say that work required for this compression with these three possibilities. So as you are doing that work can be calculated based on the PV diagram, or simply we can say that the work done during one cycle can be calculated by the area enclosed by that curve on the PV diagram. So we will follow that method only for analyzing the compression work. So in this diagram, first we will consider that A12B is a cycle which is occurring with the polytropic compression process, and for this process how much work is required, that we will calculate. So for that purpose, let us see how to calculate it. So we are knowing that the polytropic compression is following PV raised to N is equal to constant, this law, and we are following that work required for this cycle, that is A12B, is nothing but the area enclosed by this diagram or by this cycle on PV graph or PV plot. So we can say that work required is equal to area A12B. Now this area can be calculated by area 2B plus area 12 minus area A1. Okay, so that can be written as for P22 we are having the simply P2V2, while for 1 to 2, that is a polytropic process, we have discussed this part in the thermodynamics. For polytropic process, the area or the work required for polytropic process can be given as P2V2 minus P1V1 divided by N-1, while the area under A21 is nothing but P1V1. So we can have the work polytropic is like this. If you simplify this equation, then we can get the final work done relation is like this, that is work done during the polytropic compression is nothing but N upon N minus 1 P1V1 into bracket P2 by P1, that is we can say that pressure ratio, that is delivery pressure upon suction pressure raised to N minus 1 upon N minus 1. Now this statement is very important, and you have to remember it for solving the problems as well as for exam solving, having the derivation also in the examinations. Now this can be simplified, and we can convert these expressions in terms of the temperatures. So for that purpose, you can write, instead of P1V1, we can write MRT1, and that equation will become N upon N minus 1 MRT1 P2 upon P1 raised to N minus 1 upon N minus 1. And if you can replace this P2 by P1 with T2 by T1 raised to N upon N minus 1, then we can write W polytropic is nothing but N upon N minus 1 is equal to MR T2 minus T1. These two equations are important for polytropic compression process. You have to remember where the notations are indicating the initial and final conditions. Okay, so this is for the polytropic compression. Similarly, we can go for the isentropic compression, where the reversible adiabatic process can occur, that is 1 to " is a isentropic process or reversible adiabatic process, where the heat losses are zero. Then similar to that polytropic process, you can derive this relation also with the help of area 1A2-B. And that can be calculated similar to that one, area 2-B plus area 1-2 minus area A1. The only change in this case will be occurred during the polytropic, instead of polytropic process, you will have the reversible adiabatic process, and the equation or that area 1-2 is going to change to P2V2 minus P1V1 upon gamma minus 1, where gamma is the adiabatic index. And this can be simplified, and we will get that gamma upon gamma minus 1 P1V1 P2 upon P1 raised to gamma minus 1 upon gamma minus 1, means only that gamma N is replaced with the gamma for isentropic process, otherwise the formula will be same. Now again you can replace that pressure volume with the temperatures, and you will get the final expression like gamma upon gamma minus 1 mr T2 minus T1. So the expressions for polytropic and reversible adiabatic processes are same, only the gamma and n are going to replace it to each other. So you can remember it easy. So this is the second case. Now let us see the third case. Third case is nothing but that isothermal process, and in isothermal process we are having the A12-B process. Here the two line is showing the green line. So again we can go for the same method, that by calculating the area enclosed by A12-B we can calculate the work done during that isothermal process. So that is nothing but area 2-B plus area 1-2 minus area A1. Now in this case the area 1-2 is going to change, and that actually for isothermal process we are knowing that can be calculated by P1 V1 log of P2 by P1. One more important thing is in this case is that this is isothermal process, so this is following the law PV is equal to constant, means what, P1 V1 is equal to P2 V2. So P2 V2 and P1 V1, if those are same then we can deduct it from each other, and we will have the final expression like P1 V1 log of P2 by P1. So this is the isothermal work. This can be replaced with the temperatures, that P1 V1 you can replace with the MR T1 log of P2 by P1. So this is the expression for isothermal work. Okay, so if we see that the combinedly three processes, then but obvious that 1-2 is isothermal process which requires the minimum work, because it is showing you the minimum area, while P2-, which is a reversible adiabatic, and it requires the maximum work for the compression. So we can say that the isothermal process is a economical process for the compression, which is we can consider as ideal process for the compression, and we can try to achieve that isothermal compression in all practices, as we are knowing that it requires very slow processes, which is not possible in the actual case, but we can try to get the isothermal process. So for getting the isothermal process there are different ways, that the most important thing is that you have to do increase the heat transfer, and that in heat transfer can be increased by applying the different type techniques of the cooling, that you can use the coolant, you can use the fins, you can use the air motion over the cylinder so that it gets cool and heat transfer will be more. Again the multi-staging of the compression may be used for getting the isothermal process, or you may go for the multi-cylinder engines also for getting the isothermal process. See, in some cases the water injection also is applied during the compression process, so that the temperature will be maintained constant, it will not allow to increase much, so that we can try towards to get the isothermal process, so that we will have the minimum work. So in with this analysis we can conclude that the isothermal process is the ideal process for compression, while isentropic process is the worst process for the compression. So every time we will try to get this isothermal process, and for comparing the actual conditions with the ideal conditions, we will use isothermal as the ideal one. Okay, now let us discuss the performance parameters of compressor. Based on the dimensions and working, we can have the different performance parameters. So let us understand some terminologies before going for the actual performance parameters. The terminology is similar to the IC engines that we have studied in unit 1 and 1 to 5. But let us revise it. So we are knowing that when the piston is at the extreme top position, then it is called as the top dead center. When the piston is at the extreme bottom position, that is called as the bottom dead center. The distance between top dead and bottom dead center is called as stroke. When the volume between top dead and bottom dead center is called as swept volume, and the volume which is available above the top dead center is called as a clearance volume. So clearance volume and swept volume combinedly called as a total volume. So these are the some terminology that we are having. Now let us see how to calculate the swept volume first. So swept volume is nothing but the bore area into the stroke length. So in this case, if the diameter D is there for the bore, then we can calculate it pi by 4 D square L when you are having the single acting cylinder, means the air is on a single on a one side of the piston, it is not on the both sides, but it's on the only one side. Then we can have that pi by 4 D square L, and this swept volume is having the meter cube per stroke per cylinder. If you are having per stroke, means it is only for one cycle, you are going to suck this much volume. If you are having double acting, means on both sides you are having the air, then you have to multiply the twice because we are having the twice area. So it is 2 into pi by 4 D square L meters cube per stroke per cylinder. Now if you are having the number of cylinders are K, and I want to calculate that swept volume per second basis, then you have to multiply it number of strokes per second. So in this case N dash by 60 is the number of strokes per second, and K is the number of cylinders. So you can say that where N dash is equal to N, that is the RPM of this compressor for the single acting compressor, while it is twice N for double acting compressors. So N dash is nothing but the number of strokes per minute, and if you take it N dash double divided by 60, it is nothing but the number of strokes per second. So when you want to calculate the swept volume per second basis, then you have to use this formula. It is pi by 4 D square L N dash upon 60 into K, where N dash is the number of strokes per minute and K is the number of cylinders. So and that N dash can be calculated based on the RPM, that is speed of the compressor. So this is the swept volume that you can have. Now in some cases, instead of giving the cylinder dimensions, that piston speed may be given, average piston speed or mean piston speed is given. In there are some type of problems in which instead of giving the dimensions, that is L and D, the average or mean piston speed is given. Then how you will calculate it? So that can be calculated by the formula twice L M by 60. So what is the, how you are going to get it? That can be calculated like this, that L is the distance traveled by the piston in one stroke, then twice L will be the distance traveled in the one cycle. So how many cycles are there in 1 second? That is N by 60. So likewise you can calculate twice L N by 60, that is average piston speed. Remember this, that this is the speed of the piston, not of the crankshaft or crank. So when you are getting it in the meter per second, then that this formula you have to use. Then let us go to the next parameter, that is indicated power of the compressor, and which we can say that IP of the compressor, and this is nothing but calculated based on the thermodynamic work per second. It can be calculated based on the thermodynamic work per second, and we have calculated that thermodynamic work for different processes, for polytropic process, isothermal process and reversible adiabatic process. So you can calculate indicated power as W, that is work we can say that per cycle, and multiply by N dash, that is number of cycles per per minute divided by 60, which will come in the kilowatts. So indicated power is mentioned in terms of the kilowatt especially. And if you are calculating W by the previous formulas, whatever we have seen, that is coming in kilojoules per cycle. Now that kilojoules per cycle, so you have to convert into the kilowatts, that is kilojoule per second. So you have to multiply it with the number of cycles per second, and if you multiply it with the N dash by 60, means number of cycles per second, then you will get the indicated power in the kilowatt. So this indicated power is useful to find out how much shaft power you require. And for that purpose, we are having one relation, that is mechanical efficiency of a compressor is nothing but indicated power upon shaft power. So shaft power is nothing but the electrical power you are supplying to the motor, and that motor is giving the power to the shaft, that is called the shaft power. So shaft power and integrated power is nothing but the thermodynamic power that is required by the thermodynamic processes, that is polytropic process, isothermal process, and reversible adiabatic process we have calculated. So interestingly, you have to see that mechanical efficiency of compressor is equal to indicated power upon shaft power. And if you compare this formula with IC engines, then that is mechanical efficiency is nothing but brake power upon indicated power. So it is a reverse of that. You have to take care, as it is a work generating device. IC engine is a work generating device while compressor is a work absorbing device. So if you are having that mechanical efficiency like this, then next terminology is used, that is isothermal efficiency, which is very important point in the compressor, because we are going to calculate or compare the actual process of compression with the ideal process. Then that can be measured with the isothermal efficiency, and that isothermal efficiency can be defined as the ideal work divided by actual work. Now in this case, ideal work we are going to consider as isothermal work, while actual work we are going to consider as a polytropic, or it may be the work given by the electricity. So that can be calculated based on whatever the data is available. If the polytropic work is given, then we can calculate that isothermal efficiency, isothermal work upon polytropic work. And if the electrical energy is given, then you can calculate it as isothermal work upon actual work. So this is the one of the term that you are going to find out during the compressor.